And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect Andromeda. I'm the RPG chick. In our quarters now for the next reading. We're listening to Dr. Perceptron? Hyperion. Well, the other tunes are very much like have a high drum beat, and hopefully this tune doesn't go there. We'll see. So anyway, more Codex readings. We've read all this. Now Andromeda species. The Andromeda galaxy is home to many new intelligent species and other forms of life. Not so intelligent. Angara. Data on the biology, culture, and history of the Angara species. Cool. Oh wow. Ephra de Tershav. Before Ephra de Tershav assumed command of the Resistance, he claims it was a disorganized and ineffectual group of zealots who were sliding into irrelevance. In fact, Jal explains it was the Resistance's failure to protect Ephra's family from the Kett that drove Ephra to join the group, with the goal of turning it into the effective guerrilla army it aspired to be. Resistance distributed literature explains that Ephra's single-minded dedication to his cause became evident when he led a successful raid on a Kett slave labor camp, reporting that Ephra's resistance forces liberated hundreds of Angaran prisoners before wiping out an entire battalion of Kett sent to stop the attack. According to Jal, Ephra is feared by his resistance subordinates and respected by Angaran leaders, but he remains an isolated individual. He keeps no close ties, by design. Everyone in the Resistance is expendable, and Ephra is said to understand too well the pain that comes with losing those closest to him. I'm actually gonna move, like, closer to this, since you can only hear it out of one speaker sitting here. This sounds better. Oh, I didn't mean to hit that. I wanted to hit this. Now it only comes out of the left speaker. Oh well, guys. I tried. Angaran culture. Our first cultural exchanges quickly reveal that there is no homogeneous Angaran culture. Development on separate planets has left striking differences in Angaran social norms that are yet to be reconciled. Some common threads can be established. The Angara prize familial unity, preferring to live, work, and raise children in extended family groups. Political factions tend to emerge from these extended families, with leaders elected by popular support. Spirituality has a role in Angaran daily life, with their calendar making space for the religious holidays of many different faiths. As a safe and hospitable garden world, Aya has emerged as a center of Angaran society and trade. With many communities facing harsh conditions and research shortages, a lottery system is used to transfer personnel to Aya for extended periods. These Rabba-Garesson, roughly sanctuary trips, also serve to pool reclaimed scientific knowledge and military strategy. Angaran languages. Angaran linguists describe between 200 to 300 public languages across their combined settlements. When accounting for family languages spoken privately and passed down over generations, the number climbs rapidly into the thousands. The language is used by most Angara across the Helios cluster is Salesh, a lingua franca that was commonly used in the early days of Angaran spaceflight before fading into obscurity. New connections between Angaran settlements and constant evolution of languages since their separation means it has now seen a revival. Sources say Shalesh, originally meant to barter for the moon, apparently a joke or pun around the idea of trading between interstellar colonies. Some terms. Angara. Noun. Civilized people. Those who have put down roots, derived from Ang, meaning Angkor. Dar, noun, rock, the term for a village or small outpost. Jerevion, noun, a galaxy. Have Herevion, or whatever, means our galaxy, commonly referring to Andromeda, while Herevion Imasaf, the massive shell galaxy, refers to the Milky Way. Para, verb, to know or to learn. Shena, N, the mouth. Tavatan, noun, a friend or trusted comrade, one who would be vouched for to the rest of the family. Vesagara, noun, uprooted people, exiles, a derogatory term for those from the Milky Way, most often used by the Rokar. Oh, nice. Speaking of which, the Rokar. Jal describes the Rokar as dangerous cousins. Ruthless and single-minded, the Rokar's propaganda describes their intent to drive all alien invaders, both Milky Way and Kett, out of the Helios cluster. The Rokar are founded by Axul, a charismatic Angara who once studied with the Moshe. Jal explains that Axul was captured by the Kett and held in a forced labor camp for over a standard year while the Resistance could not risk a rescue. Though he survived, Axul was embittered against the Resistance and alien life. Upon his escape, he recruited young Angara and disaffected Resistance members into an independent force named after the fearsome soldiers from Angaran mythology, the Rokar. The arrival of the Nexus, portrayed as further invaders by Axul, provoked the Rokar past breaking point. They are now engaged in full-fledged guerrilla operations against all non-Angaran inhabitants of the cluster. The Angaran Resistance officially disavows the Rokar, but family and political interconnections complicate any organized opposition to them. Angaran technology. Considering their civilization endured both the immense disaster of the Scourge and the brutal Kett invasion, Angara possess remarkably advanced technology. Their starships, while generally small and bare-bones functional, are more than capable of keeping peace with Andromeda Initiative vessels. Angara use advanced communications and computer systems that have quickly adapted to interface with Milky Way devices, helping to smooth through some of the technological hurdles of first contact. When it comes to personal technology, Angara have focused primarily on defensive and offensive innovations. Their weapons and armor are impressive enough to garner approval from Krogan who have witnessed them in battle, and are designed to work seamlessly with the innate Angaran control over electromagnetism. The Angara are in turn fascinated by Milky Way Omnitools and have already begun experimenting with the technology for their own use. The Angara have also had decades to study Kett technology firsthand. If relations remain cordial, this technological knowledge may become invaluable. Angara, the Resistance. The arrival of the Kett stunned and then divided the Angara. As described by Jal, infighting was used as a means of conquest by the Kett, but the presence of a common enemy eventually galvanized the Angara to work together. The various Resistance groups merged into the organized Angaran Resistance roughly 5 years ago under Ephra T. Tarshav's command, supported by prominent families and determined to stop their Kett oppressors. The Resistance's headquarters are on Aya. For security reasons, neither Ephra nor Jal will provide details of the Resistance's organizational structure, but it can be assumed there are multiple independent cells across the cluster. Many non-Resistance Angara support their work either logistically or financially. The Resistance specializes in assassination, sabotage of Kett facilities, deployment of supplies to besieged populations, and the rescue and rehabilitation of Angaran prisoners. Many members of the Angaran Resistance have joined up with the Nexus Militia, enlisting Apex support for their missions. Some senior officers have opened treaty negotiations with the Nexus. Okay, we got Angara itself, or themselves. The Angara are the only known sentient species local to the Helios cluster. Scattered across numerous worlds, the Angara are reuniting as a people. Though much of their culture and scientific knowledge has been lost, the Angara continue to rebuild and resist the conquest of Helios. From our cultural exchanges, we know that the Angara have a unique control over electromagnetism. Specialized skin cells and organs allow them to generate and control electromagnetic fields artistically or unleash them in combat. Oral histories describe how ancient Angara were tribal and nomadic before settling in cities. Many of them still live in large, tight-knit families and workplaces have a guild-like organizational structure. Politically, the Angara remain divided. Attempts at a reform government were disrupted by the Kett. Approximately 5 years ago, a coherent resistance movement emerged on Aya, the first to draw unilateral political support with the goal of driving the Kett out of Helios for good. Angaran history. Many historical records of the Angara have been lost, but what survives tells the story of how ancient Angara achieved spaceflight. Eventually, they settled on 5 separate garden worlds, including Vold. The scourge struck in approximately 2400 CE, by our calendar. The phenomenon devastated the Helios cluster, destroyed many Angaran cities, and sent their culture into a decline. This dark age lasted for over a century, before the Angara began to adapt to the new conditions in Helios. Eventually, the disparate Angara regained spaceflight capability and re-established contact with one another. But the isolation had fostered separate cultural, political, and spiritual blocks. The Angara struggled to find common ground. The struggle was ongoing when the Kett arrived 75 years ago. The Archon exploited their disparity and began a brutal conquest of the Helios cluster. Ironically, as several Angaran historians point out, a common enemy provided the impetus to unite. Today, the Angara continue their efforts at reconstruction and resistance. Drink time. Yeah, this is going to be my last episode of reading. My voice is a little strained at this point. Kett. Data on the biology, culture, and history of the Kett species. Kett fiend. Fiends are monstrous beasts with a heavily armored carapace. Unlike the stealthier wraiths, fiends are besieging units that attack head-on, scattering enemy forces and destroying entrenched enemy positions. They attack non-Kett without appearing to need orders. Some scientists believe fiends respond aggressively to an absence of Kett pheromones or similar cues. Interesting. A fiend's carapace is permeated by dense cartilage that makes it both strong and flexible, and acts as a shock absorber for incoming fire. Preliminary study of the nervous system suggests that nerve transmission is dampened above a certain pain threshold, allowing a fiend to detect injury but not be slowed by it. Reports of fiend encounters are often accompanied by casualty lists, and the militia advises that only a well-armed and organized team should handle a fiend at full rampage. Kett Ascendant. There's a lot of information. The Ascendant are the highest caste of Kett seen on the battlefield and are considered exceptionally dangerous. Apex reports that they are typically only seen when the Kett are conducting high-stakes operations or when a persistent enemy must be eliminated. Element Zero cores throughout its armor allow an Ascendant to levitate off the ground, allowing it to command the attention of subordinate Kett and rain devastating fire down upon enemies. The Ascendant appear to have biological control over electromagnetic force. Cell samples gathered at great risk show electrocyte-like formations. It is likely that an Ascendant uses equipment or implants to amplify and control this ability, allowing it to manipulate EM fields that empower its weaponry. If provoked, the Ascendant can unleash a ball lightning-like attack, which conducts electricity to nearby foes, or yank an opponent helplessly off their feet to deliver a barrage of blows. Kett, the Archon. Not much information here. He looks weird. The Kett present a mysterious but ever-present danger in the Helios cluster. As the militia struggles to gather any details on their plans or motivations, rumors have reached the nexus of the Kett's leader, a powerful military commander known as the Archon. This Archon is said to command the Kett from a dreadnought out in unknown space, and is only rarely sighted planetside. Thus far, these sightings are always at Remnant dig sites, or Kett-controlled Remnant structures. The Archon's interest in the Remnant remains unexplained, but intelligence gathering continues. Simply Kett. According to Nexus officials, the aliens encountered on Habitat 7 are known as the Kett, a species that has proven hostile in every reported encounter. Little is known about them or their motives. The Kett possess technology and weapons at least on par with the initiatives and have been responsible for the death or capture of many initiative personnel. The only commonality is that the Kett have a clear interest in the strange structures and technology seen on Habitat 7 and, as we now know, on several worlds in the Helios cluster. Scouts and prospecting teams trying to investigate this technology are invariably attacked by the Kett, who take any scans or research materials by force. Why the Kett have such an interest in this technology is unknown, but the Nexus has issued warning bulletins to all off-station teams to avoid these sites for their own safety. Kett, destined. Destined are described in intercepted communications as ancestral Kett who act as battlefield commanders. They rally infantry into tightly cohesive units, providing shield support and directing operations from the center. The most interesting characteristic of the Destined is their ability to produce an obscuring smoke cloud without mechanical assistance. Preliminary studies suggest Destined have internal sacs that excrete carbonate-rich compounds, which include a melanin-like pigment. When expelled into the air at will, internal acids trigger a gas evolution reaction, and the pigment expands to cover the battlefield, cloaking other Kett allies. While studies suggest it is not harmful, breathing the cloud for extended periods is not recommended. Oh, but that's my favorite thing to do. It is weird, I expel that from sacs in her body. Anointed. The Kett soldiers known as Anointed appear to be of similar caste to the Chosen, infantry equipped with light armor. Anointed, however, wield heavy plasma cannons, making them a rallying point for other Kett forces, and shield themselves with kinetic barriers against splashback. A barrage from an Anointed's plasma cannon can shred through enemy barriers and severely damage ground vehicles. Communication intercepts suggest that Anointed assist in coordinating Chosen squads and act in an NCO role. It is unclear if the term Anointed refers to a senior rank amongst the Chosen, or if Anointed are part of a separate division within the Kett infantry. Chosen. Chosen are the frontline soldiers of the Kett, encountered on multiple worlds as support for other Kett combatants. They are equipped with assault rifles that fire plasma-surrounded projectiles, and light armor that allows them to move and deploy rapidly. Though their biology is still under investigation, they are capable of surviving in hazardous environments without protective gear. Those bastards. While quick to defer to more senior individuals, Chosen appear to be disciplined and loyal soldiers, undeterred even by biotic attacks or heavy ordnance. They present a continuing risk to unarmed outposts. The name Chosen was intercepted and tentatively translated from Kett communications. If accurate, its significance is unclear, since these are clearly the Kett's baseline infantry. And finally, Wraith. Nicknamed by Initiative scouts unlucky enough to encounter them, Wraiths are warabees capable of adjusting their carapace pigmentation to blend into their surroundings. This ability lets them stalk an enemy over distances unseen or cause sudden disorder in enemy ranks, flushing targets to be picked off by other Kett forces. When attacking, Wraiths leap and strike with impressive jaw strength that can puncture ceramic armor. Wraiths present an interesting study to Nexus scientists. Initially believed to originate from the same homeworld as Initially believed to originate from the same homeworld as the Kett, since they have similar physical characteristics. Wraiths show clear genetic similarity with other feral creatures sighted across the Helios cluster. That's it for Kett. I have flora and fauna. Many unique plants, creatures, and other life forms inhabit the Helios cluster's worlds. They sure do. Andromeda Wildlife Overview. The nature of life in the Andromeda Galaxy was debated at length by Milky Way scholars. Many Milky Way species show convergent evolution, upright bipeds of a certain height and atmospheric tolerances, leading some to theorize this pattern might give some evolutionary advantage, despite counter-arguments by Hanar scientists. I missed a Hanar, too. Interestingly, the Kett and Angara continue to fit this pattern. The wildlife and fauna encountered in the Helios cluster have adapted to the presence of the Scourge, evolving epidermal layers or carapaces that can cope with ambient radiation, or in the case of some plants, successfully feeding off it. Many use bioluminescence to attract prey or as a threat or mating display. Concerns were raised around the ability of Milky Way species to consume proteins from Andromeda, so seed banks formed a significant part of the Ark's cargo. We now know it is safe to consume food grown or hunted here, though enzyme supplements are recommended and have become a social norm at mealtimes. Manta. Nicknamed a manta by Andromeda Initiative observers, this majestic creature has been sighted on several worlds in the Helios cluster. The Nexus scientists believe it may have originally evolved on a world with heavy deposits of element zero, giving it the ability to lower its mass enough to swim through the air. Expanding the muscular gas bladders on its underside allows the creature to rise and orient itself in flight. Despite its size, roughly 30 meters, the manta is not a threat to outposts or explorers. It appears to subsist on mineral deposits from rock formations, wrapping itself around rock spires or even against cliff faces to remain camouflaged while it feeds. Their camouflage ability suggests that these mantas have predators or other reasons to remain hidden, but thus far the reasons remain unclear. Yeah, that would be likely. Outlaws. Oh, we have not seen this one yet. Again, guys, no spoilers, but I did see something in the trailer regarding this person. Hostile rogue factions, both native and foreign, plague the Helios cluster. Outlaws. Adhi? Are four-legged life forms sighted on multiple worlds across the Helios cluster, often foraging together in packs. They're extremely intelligent and capable of understanding complex commands. Wandering explorers and mercenaries are often accompanied by one or two trained Adhi for defense. When attacking, Adhi drive opponents out of secure positions to make them vulnerable to gunfire or a concerted attack by the rest. When attacking, Adhi drive opponents out of secure positions to make them vulnerable to gunfire or a concerted attack by the rest of the pack. Their jaw strength has been measured in excess of 1900 N, whatever N stands for, dangerous even while wearing a hard suit. Adhi also show no fear of scout rovers. Yeah, try to run them over, it doesn't always work, right? Interestingly, the Adhi genomes show signs of extensive genetic engineering that resembles the uplifting of some domestic animals on Earth before gene modification laws were put in place. These adaptions allow the Adhi to survive in hazardous environments and may account for their almost tactical intelligence even in the wild. Sharpshooter. Equipped with custom-modified sniper rifles, sharpshooters accompany raiding parties as scouts and long-range combatants. A well-trained sharpshooter can pick off an unprepared explorer before they even know there are enemies nearby. Yeah, I call them snipers. The skill of many of these sharpshooters is, ironically, the result of initiative colonist defense training before leaving the Milky Way. Strategically, it was believed that well-armed snipers would be simple but effective defenders of their outposts, with a lowered risk of losing personnel in the event of an attack. It appears this training has now been passed along. Pariah. Even without military training, rogue Asari are exceptionally dangerous, as their natural biotic talents mean they are never truly disarmed. These pariahs, now sighted in outlaw bands, wield their powers in pursuit of plunder and glory. Doesn't seem typical of an Asari. No. Pariahs attack at short range with shotguns designed for Asari commando forces, wearing down kinetic barriers in preparation for a biotic-focused attack. For more persistent enemies, many pariahs have mastered a deadly backlash technique, generating a shield with near-negative mass that accelerates incoming projectiles back at their foes. Raider. The outlaw bands of the Helios cluster are diverse. Some were individuals who joined the Andromeda Initiative as an escape from the Milky Way. Some were exiled after Nexus Uprising. Others choose to seek their fortune elsewhere. Many of these initiatives survive by raiding outposts or wandering exploration teams. While not particularly organized or well-equipped, these raiders present a risk to undefended colonists. Most prefer to extort supplies and equipment rather than risk themselves, but when provoked or desperate, they will resort to deadly force. Anarchist. Turians running with outlaw bands have turned their mandatory military training to less noble purposes. So it was the Raider. Could be any, I guess. I need another drink. Yeah, I guess these can be any, or human. Specifically Asari, specifically Turian. They override their safeties on ex-military hardware to handle a higher explosive yield, resulting in deadly inferno grenades that leave thermite deposits on the ground after impact. The thermite can cling to armor and cause massive injuries. Wonderful. Apex's largely Turian volunteer force takes a dim view of these anarchists, seeing them as not only a threat but an affront to Turian values of honor and service. These who cannot be forced to surrender are hunted ruthlessly, though this has only driven anarchists to ever greater feats of military engineering. So did they name themselves anarchists and pariah? Or is this what others have chosen to call them? Because I don't see what anarchists... I guess anarchist, yeah, against the initiative, but... Which is sort of a proto-government. The Remnant. Ancient machines with mysterious goals operate throughout the Helios cluster. Interfacing. Cool. I know these. Of course I remember these, but I recognize. Remnant technology requires careful reactivation, dubbed interfacing, a process Alec Ryder and I first developed on Habitat 7. Using glyphs, dense data packets of Remnant code, a working understanding of their language, and the interface capabilities of a Pathfinder implant, I can help you trigger or control Remnant technology from appropriate locations. Interfacing is the only way to activate certain Remnant technology, such as monoliths. Scans and surface damage suggest that the Kett have repeatedly attempted to activate these sites by other, increasingly desperate methods without success. It is not clear whether Remnant technology is designed to be activated by an AI. There is no evidence of artificial intelligence in the Remnant structures investigated thus far, and Remnant bots have only rudimentary programming. However, the glyphs contain recognition keys analogous to an electroencephalogram, EEG, implying that the system is designed to handle a form of neural input. Creators. An artificial creation must have a creator, but there is scant evidence of whoever created the Remnant. I have consulted the Nexus scientist, scans obtained by PB, on the condition that I not rearrange her data, and records of your own investigation, but my conclusions remain speculation. We can be certain that the Remnant builders are several orders of sophistication above the Initiative's technology. Interlinked cluster-wide planetary engineering is beyond the logistics or budget of any known species. The energy requirements alone suggest a Type 1 civilization on the Kardashev scale. On a cultural level, the builders must have been intelligent and capable of large-scale cooperation. The proportions of the vaults and devices found suggest a species with similar physical traits to humans, but with no genetic evidence left behind, their appearance, along with their motivations, remain a mystery. Breacher. Created by assemblers, these breachers are levitating drones that move in rapid, aggressive bursts using a powerful microthruster. PB claims to have named them breachers after mistaking one for an observer, and quickly realizing this new example broke the rules. Analysis of breacher debris shows that their systems are fundamentally unstable. Their power cores are improperly shielded, and many of their inner workings are exposed. This suggests they are created for short-term deployment to handle intruders who stray into Remnant territory, and in turn offer some insight into the Remnant Builder's military doctrine. Combined with single-minded programming that focuses on hostiles, the volatile construction of breachers makes them extremely dangerous. If provoked, the breacher will launch itself at an opponent and attempt to latch onto it, using exposed gears to grind through hard suits and cause severe damage. When damaged beyond repair, a breacher may trigger its power core to overload and self-destruct. I love that little feature, don't we? Decryption. Most Remnant technology is inert or in a standby mode, but some is secured with a decryption grid. Unlocking it requires scanning the correct Remnant glyphs and arranging them in a specific order. The glyphs cannot repeat on any straight line or within a square block of four. PB speculates that this could be a safety measure. Even if a method was devised to brute force hack an interface, it would not work with the decryption grid. Given the devastating consequences when Remnant technology is improperly activated, her analysis seems sound. The arrangement of the glyphs appears to complete either a password or a code phrase within the grid as a whole. From the little I understand of the Remnant language, they appear to form almost a palindromic satyr square sentence, but the finer meaning would require detailed explanation from the grid's designer. Yeah, we're not going to have that, not yet anyway. Remnant Destroyer. Destroyers are heavy weapon platforms deployed against the most determined intruders into Remnant territory. Armed with a directed energy cannon and two secondary laser turrets that can engage multiple targets simultaneously, a single destroyer can take out an entire combat squad in minutes. When asked why she named it a destroyer, PB folded her arms, rolled her eyes, and answered, "You figure it out." One of the most disconcerting characteristics of the destroyer is its partitioned power system. Destroying one of its turrets means that power is automatically diverted to its locomotion systems, allowing it to move much faster. Many individuals have mistakenly believed they could pick off a destroyer's turrets from a distance and evade it safely, only to have the destroyer close that distance unexpectedly. This often has fatal consequences, since at melee range the destroyer transfers power to electromagnetic burst that causes severe damage to any individuals unlucky enough to be close. Apex has reported variants of the destroyer that have a self-repair network for their turrets. These destroyers can briefly go dormant, transferring full power to fix any damage before reactivating its turrets again. Few have been sighted, but engagement is not recommended. Remnant Nullifier. This Remnant model appears to have been designed for excavation. If provoked, it enters a siege mode, where it anchors itself to the ground and launches explosive projectiles at a target. In this mode, this Remnant constantly runs a self-repair cycle, reducing damage from incoming fire. PB claims that this characteristic is what earned it the name Nullifier. Recovery of Nullifier parts has been illuminating. They use both balancing pitons and dense ferrofluid reservoirs in their lower extremities to remain stable while firing. Design characteristics that could be useful for initiative mining operations. Their blast shielding is also surprisingly light for its thickness, 72 millimeters, and density. The plates are cushioned by a honeycomb of shock-absorbing polymer to distribute any ballistic force. However, these characteristics are also what allows them to absorb heavy fire and act as formidable opponents. Remnant Assembler. They were nicknamed for their ability to create smaller units known as breachers, previously seen. Each assembler contains a reservoir of an unknown ferrofluid similar to Omnigel, which can be used to 3D print breachers on the spot with alarming speed. Wow, 3D print. Tactically, assemblers focus on manufacturing reinforcements, moving to safe distances during combat. If approached while in its hostile mode, the assembler can jettison the partially completed power core of a breacher, which acts like an explosive grenade, causing massive damage to enemies and allowing the assembler to withdraw. Upon creating a breacher, the assembler transfers a full copy of its stored recent memory and battlefield disposition to the new Remnant, ensuring it is combat-ready almost immediately. This capability means the assembler is constantly branching and partitioning its memory in preparation without loss of data, an interesting characteristic that may be useful in future artificial intelligence designs. So that's assembler. We have two more. The Remnant. Remnant is the umbrella term coined for technology, structures, and autonomous bots that have been sighted across the Helios cluster. Seemingly abandoned by whoever created it, this Remnant technology is extremely advanced, but most of it is in a standby state. On Habitat 7, Alec Ryder discovered that reactivating this technology requires scanning glyphs, data packets written in Remnant coding language, and my assistance with interfacing at particular consoles. This is complicated by Remnant bots that still guard and maintain many of these installations. Remnant bots do not appear to be sentient, but they are programmed to consider any interference with their technology as a hostile act and attack single-mindedly. The Kett have an interest in Remnant technology and have been sighted across the cluster attempting to study or control sites where it is still active. Evidence suggests the Kett have not yet developed a reliable method of interfacing. Awesome. We can do it, haha. Remnant Observer. Observers mid to long range Remnant drones can be seen at most Remnant sites. They are equipped with Element Zero cores that allow them to levitate, and can normally be seen scanning or conducting maintenance at these sites. While they are the least robust of the Remnant bots, observers are still a threat to unprepared explorers if provoked. Examination of destroyed Remnant observers shown they have multiple sensor vectors, visual, oral, and electromagnetic, and others as yet undefined, and a comprehensive toolkit of equipment for observation and maintenance, including an ultraviolet beam laser. Serving partially as its primary weapon, the frequencies of an observer's laser appear to react with Remnant structures to induce a repair cycle. Observers are also capable of bringing other Remnant online, likely as part of their maintenance duties. When asked, PB explains the name observers with, "Everywhere you go, they seem to be looking at you." Okay. So that's the end of that whole section. Andromeda species. So the only ones we have left are planets and locations, technology, ships and vehicles, which we will read at another point. At some point, these four, I'm sure, are going to be updated with more entries, and we'll read them as well, of course. Thanks so much for watching. See you in the next episode when we do not read Codex. I can't see myself like that. Oh, that's... looks horrible there. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.